Hello everybody, it's Isabella from Prior Tie again, and yet again I'm saying hello to you and my under things, but that's the nature of things in dressing up, I suppose. Today we are looking at Elizabethan era, basically 70s, 80s, into the 80s, but a garment that would be mostly suited to riding, as I've made it for my next book, The Equestrian Dressmaker. So the patterns and instructions will be there. I've also made it for a friend of mine who is a very similar size to model it for me, so I haven't worn it yet, so it's going to be interesting to see whether it fit it or not. Well, we are looking at the usual under things. The garments at that time just about start being more used to riding as opposed to everyday clothing. You could still ride in your everyday clothing, especially if you're wearing a side saddle and a plunk shirt. There was a growing trend of using more masculine fashions for riding, so we are looking at a bit more of that. I have my usual favourite chemise, which I made, must be about 20 years ago or so. And it has this detail. Basically each piece of the chemise is made and hemmed separately and then joined at the seams with a decorative seaming and then stitching, which is a bit of a pain to make, but I absolutely love it how it looks. So that's it. I've got my wool stockings and my American Duchess Elizabethan shoes. And the first layer that you see in the 80s, and it's a very peculiar cut that you see, is a kirtle. So a kirtle is a layer, something new. And this one is still stiffened with buckram with a little bit of breech boning, but not a lot, because you still don't really wear space that much. At least we don't have that much evidence for it being worn at that place. And this is wool satin and lined with linen. And it laces at the side, but at the side backs. So that will be a little bit tricky to get into, so I might have my usual maid to help me out. We were supposed to be filming this with another friend of mine, with Serena from Dressing History, but unfortunately she fell a victim to flu or whatever lurgy is hanging around at the moment in the UK, so she couldn't make it, so, which is a great pity because she's got the lovely Elizabethan kit as well. So it would be nice to see and have a little bit more for you. Right. I think I managed to get through without losing my coif. So as you can see, the lacing is very much at the back, and you can see that on a few illustrations from the period. So that is going to be quite tricky to get on my own. I think a little bit of break, and I need to have my trusty maid to help you a bit. Right, as if by magic, I have my kirtle on. That's basically what you see on the period illustration, which is great. You can loosen it out if you are pregnant or you have a hearty dinner, I suppose. So that's still quite handy. So I managed to get the kettle. It's a little bit short-waisted for me. My waist is actually here. So a couple of inches short, but it doesn't really impede much. And that's sort of a pretty look, which we'll explore a little bit later on. Right, now for riding I may or I may not wear a bum roll. This would be silk linen stuffed with leftover bits and pieces from your sewing, nothing that gets wasted, or you can stuff it with some sheep's wool, I suppose, nice and comfy. So this can go here. Probably for riding I would avoid it, but I'm not riding today. Kathy did that for me. So let's have a look how this looks. That's good. The skirt. Now this look is based on sort of two odd bits from the period, to Elizabeth's portrait, the Darnley portrait, her sort of Polish gown, and a cutout or woodcut of a woman's riding. This is made in silk, so obviously not ideal for riding, but again, as a court lady, you don't really do very strenuous riding. So that would be just fine to sit in the saddle and have for your falcon do all the job, I suppose. Right, there's the back. Okay. The skirts of that era are all cartridge pleated, which makes it much easier to adjust. And I've got lacing at the back, just in case. But it can be closed with hooks and eyes, whichever is preferable. Let me just close it up and shimmy back on. Doesn't look too bad with the bum roll, I suppose. It's pretty long, but for riding, doesn't really matter. It's quite a fashionable set of colours as well, because you see quite a lot of golds in different colourways, in a way, or different shades. You see old gold, the bright gold. Here you get, as always, nice black and variants of golds, browns and mustard. So that's not a bad choice of fabric, as I say myself. I made it, so I suppose self-congratulatory. Now the bodice is not dissimilar from other bodices of that era, but it is high up, very much like a men's doublet. My goodness, that was some modern era intruding on us. It's lined with linen, and it has quite a sturdy foundation, which is boned inside the front, so it has boning inside on some buckram. The sleeves have, see if I can have a look, have inside boning as well to support them. It's tricky to get it out, but you may just have a peek inside. I'm not sure if it's going to show much. Probably not. Oh yeah, the handy person with it. So you can see these two bits are two bones that are supporting that shape. And we will talk about shaping of the sleeve in the 90s video as well. But you can have a removable sleeve support just for the sleeve head, or you can have a farthingale sleeve that goes inside the sleeve and basically keeps it all the time. But this one will do just as well. Another interesting feature is the inside lacing. We have lacing here. This is very popular in the period, and that feature stays, to be honest, for several centuries, because this bit, basically once you lace, takes all the strain from the buttons. So you're not straining buttons, you're not straining buttonholes. In case if one button just falls off, you're still okay, it doesn't gape. If your bodice was pinned in or as well, it's all hooked in with hooks and eyes, again takes the strain off it. And we see this kind of lacing strips in 17th century on the inside, on the outside. You can see it in 18th century in different robes. I think we have a mantua one that shows it quite nicely. And even in Victorian era, you have sort of vestiges of that idea in a waist stay. Waist stay is exactly just there to take pressure from the buttons at the point where the most pressure is, which is usually its waistline. But sometimes you have a wider lacing panels as well. So that's a very interesting thing. It worked, so you might as well keep it. Now before I put this one on, I'm going to put them a little rough as well, so that it stays. That's okay, I can deal with that. So it stays inside. Now usually it will be put together a partlet. But I detached it for something else. Forgot for what. Right, the moment of truth. I'm in. The ruff is in. Let's lace in. And again, it's a very long lace here, but I'll just do it spiral lacing. I don't need that much. At that time you do see a lot of more masculine styles for ladies, especially for riding or travelling, mostly because it was just easier. You know, you don't really want to have bloody colletage for travelling outside, and here everything is nicely closed down and protected from the sun or other elements. But of course, men complained. Just fancy that. And there's a couple of texts when basically blokes complain that women are taking over men's attire and wearing doublet bodices. This obviously didn't stop women wearing them. Just the opposite, I would say, as usual. It was comfortable, it worked, so why not? Right, we always have through. The little lacing strip here is actually a little bit boned, so it's actually easier to lace and it will keep the shape better. I think we'll be alright with that stuff. Kathy has very similar measurements to mine, so usually we can share bits and pieces. And I've had a few videos with her before. I think you might know her as Mrs. Crockham. Mm-hmm. I'm just going to tighten it up. Again, the cord can be lucidated cord, like here, lucidated silk. It can be linen, it can be wool, or well, linen tape as well. Would work very nicely. I'm really partial to the plaited ones because they are slightly elastic. So they do lace easier and adapt to your body a little bit more, stretching when necessary. A little bit more. Take the strain off the buttons. I don't want to lace it too tight, so the top is fine, I think. Just to waste a bit more. If you lace too tight, then your buttons will open or your hook and eyes will open because there's no tension to keep them closed. So it's still quite an accurate science, really. And I think that's about right. A bit more here. And yes, it is much easier when you have it made. Right, we're in. Now, the rest of the bodice is basically buttons and loops from the braiding. So I don't really want those loops to take a lot of strain because they're mostly decorative. A handy light person helping out. And this style with frogging originated from the Eastern Europe, basically, Hungary and Poland, so hence the Polish gown, as it's sometimes called. might be a different gallery. I might have Mother Love, I will check my references. Polish and Eastern European styles were very, very different at that point. And we do have a lot of frogging. And again, that never really went out of style completely. Or at least it sort of resurfaces a lot. Lots of 17th century, later 17th century jackets, just like us, have decorative either buttonholes or tabs on both sides. Same 18th century, you have the decorative frogging typical in the Victorian era. Lots of hussars. It's just a nice look. It's a little bit of... Am I doing it all right? But I missed something? No, I'm okay. For once, buttons cooperate. Unheard of. So it was quite a fetching style, and Elizabeth did get a visit from Polish ambassadors at that time, hence... This is quite cute, actually. I'm liking it. It's quite comfy. I need to put my wrist straps as well. One. And two. The impromptu cameraman here for some reason. I will adjust it later. I'm too busy doing the bloody rocks now. Oh, I said bloody. Not as bad as fuck as last time. Some people took umbrage, but you know. Things may happen like that. I may say something. I'm going to give it to my helper. In the meantime, a little bit more about hair. My hair is cleverly hidden underneath a coif at the moment. Mostly because it's very, very short. And for riding, I would be wearing a hat over that, which I forgot to bring to the venue. Fortunately, we have photos of Kathy wearing a coif and a hat, which I've made. Not the best hat, but it worked for riding. So for this one, my little ruffs. I mean, pin them to the sleeves. Normally, I would just tack it on so that they stay in place and don't interfere with any equestrian activities. Yeah, some pins I needed. So basically, a hat, either a tall hat, again, very masculine fashion, or a little beret, soft hat, again, a very masculine fashion. But these were worn because they were convenient, and you can see quite a lot of gentlewomen or townswomen wearing sort of this kind of attire as well. And we look back at it in a second. Right, what was wrong here? I think I need to move things, but I'm not sure which way out. Oh, I know which way out. This way out. My bum moved with it. Yes, some pins needed, which I'm doing in a second. But basically, I'm sort of ready for a ride. Possibly you would get a little more bling, a couple of pearls or chains. A belt might not be out of the option as well, especially a decorative one. If you're not wearing coffin, looking at the ears, get a little pearl earrings as well. And at that point, we are starting seeing a little bit more makeup for women as well. So, rather fashionable, pale complexion, red lips, occasionally a little bit of a coal used for the eyebrows, not much. But it's sort of getting momentum for the next decade, which we will cover in one of the videos as well. So I'm going to take this one for a walk around, weather permitting. We just had hail, but I think it's cleared up and take some photos, even without the correct attire. I might change my hair in a second. But I'll be back and we will look at other use of the kirtle and other styles you can wear with a kirtle at that time. So don't go away yet. I might say fuck another time. Well, I'm back in my walk. As you can see, I've changed to a different hairstyle. Put some gloves on. And at the moment we are having a look at a different frock. So I'm going to take off my gown. Hopefully it will be less time than putting it on. But it basically shows that you did not have to have an entirely different set of clothing for the rest of the day. So if you came back from riding and your gown was a little bit, well, worse for wear, say, or muddy or wet, you did not have to change everything else, unless your kettle was soaked through as well. Mine isn't yet. It's quite nice reverse actually. Keep a different stomacher here. That's how it started, I suppose. And obviously you did not really want to be wearing expensive gowns or muddy gowns in your household when you were going around your everyday duties. Because, you know, even as a gentlewoman or catwoman would have some duties. So you stay in your kirtle and it basically serves as a base for a whole other books. So that's what we're going to use it for as well. Going to get my little rufflets out as well. So much faster. Just gonna get this out. Ta-da! All the courtly stuff goes out. Bumble goes out. Can I shimmy through? Yes, I can. Yes, I can. And then I can have a nap before going and doing stuff something. Or I can just wear a little bit different attire. Now, you will wear sleeves, and you have a lot of sleeves that are being pinned on or laced on your kirtles. The color of sleeves or plain sleeves, it really depended. But also, you can have knitted ones. Now these ones are from the Tudor Taylor's newest book, The Typical Tudor, and they're knitted by a friend of mine. There you go. I can't knit for a toffee, I'm afraid, to that pattern. And from the yarn provided by the Tudor Taylor as well. They are selling kits, I understand. So if you want to have one knitted for you, or if you want to knit one, how cute is that? You just pin here, so it has a nice little tab, and you have beautiful knitted sleeves. And these ones will be worn for lower class, middle class, and also fancy like these ones for upper class, especially in winter, and especially indoors, I suppose. Oops. Well, you don't have anything else to do, and you just want to keep your joints happy in old age. And just pin them. So I'm really pleased with these. I mean, even little mini wraps here. So this one with an apron, and I can be doing some accounts or lace making or knitting, whatever, or I could have another gown on. There are a variety of loose and fitted over gowns for that period. This one is a loose variety. And it can be made in silk or in wool, depending on the season or your social status. I'm really partial to these because they can be worn in a very different ways. And they came in different designs as well. As I say, you can have a separate fitted bodice. You can have a loose gown like this one. You can have one with revers or without. Just take a moment. I should really put my parkette on. Let me cover it. They can have little nice frogging or other fastening. And the sleeves can be either short or long sleeves. So really a whole plethora of styles available for the period. A very simple, fashionable and comfortable style. I'm going to have a girdle as well. I should have some girdle around there, possibly in one of those boxes. There we go, a girdle coming. So if you want it, you can just put a girdle on and we are in. And again, they can be decorated, they can be left plain. Loads and loads of options available to an Elizabethan woman. And that is just so cute, especially with those sleeves. So I'm going to stain it for a bit, I think. So yeah, I do recommend the Tudor Taylor's newest book. Loads of interesting information there. I've already gleaned quite a lot. And if you enjoyed my presentation today, buy me a coffee. Thank you for watching.